Well, a very good evening to one and all watching us in your respective homes through Facebook. And it's indeed a pleasure to always connect with the community. And today, we'd like to appreciate Dr. Ambedkar for joining us this evening. And of course, we'd like to say welcome to Biocon, who's our partners in joining us in creating an awareness on the journey of CKD and making this journey as easy as possible from the physical, mental, and emotional perspective. Without further delay, once again, wherever you are this evening, a warm welcome to Dr. Ambedkar. And a few words about Dr. this evening, a nephrologist and a transplant physician at Jahangir Hospital, Pune. With more than 25 years of experience, Dr. has been associated with more than 500 transplants. And he was one of the first to do the swab transplant in the city of Pune in the year 2008. He's actively involved in the cadaver organ transplant program and presently the secretary of the Pune branch for the Indian Society of Nephrologists. Once again, Doc, thank you for joining us and your time is indeed greatly appreciated.
Thank you so much.
And today we're going to be talking about a topic that is really, really interesting, post-transplant medicines and tests. The one thing that is common for all of us is we all go to different doctors and we all have different tests coming up, and that's something we keep talking about within the community. But today we have the one and only Dr. Ambedkar to join us and give us his perspectives on addressing your questions on the various tests. So may I request Dr. Ambedkar to please take over the forum and set a tone for this evening.
Thank you so much. Thank you for the kind words. Good evening, everyone. It's my great pleasure to be with you all in sharing and mainly answering whatever questions that you would be having pertaining to kidney transplants. As all of us know, over the last few decades, we've been coming across more and more people reaching of kidney disease, reaching end-stage renal disease, either going on to dialysis or requiring a transplant. Now, just for an introduction, kidney transplant happens to be or is the one of the most best options for any person. Hello?
Yeah, Doc, you're audible.
Best option for patients who require renal replacement therapy. By having a successful kidney transplant, we replace the excretory as well as the hormonal function of the kidney. So the patients who undergo a successful transplant do not require to be on dialysis, do not need any erythropoietin injections, or their bone disease is also taken care of. At the same time, these patients do need to be on regular medicines, which their treating nephrologists and treating physicians would obviously advise them. So we are going to cover questions pertaining to that. And on a regular basis, they need to undergo tests, which is this topic all about. So as I said, transplant happens to be the best option for patients with end-stage renal disease. So now with this short introduction, I would leave the audience to ask questions, because as I said, it would be more to sort out their problems rather than having a monologue and me just speaking. So any questions right from the beginning you have?
Yes, Doc. Doc, before getting into the questions, I want to understand that since we've all been in a very, very different environment in the recent past, the last 1.5 years, the COVID has changed, the way practices happen, the COVID has changed, the way we live, and everything has changed. So can you give us an insight of recently transplanted patients? How is the practice? Because, you know, post-transplant, immediately there's a lot of visits to the hospitals. Can you give us an insight on that so that people who are waiting to get transplanted will not wait for the COVID phase to pass away when they put the system into place?
That was a very good question. To be frank with you all, the numbers of transplants that we've been doing have drastically dropped in the last 2 years. One thing was in the initial phases, that is right in the beginning of the COVID pandemic in March 2020 late and later on, we were not very sure how this disease is going to behave, what is going to unfold, and how are we going to protect our patients from COVID. So initially, most of the hospitals had put their transplant program on hold till we got to know about how to deal with the disease. And also there was the reason why the numbers had dropped was also that the patients were scared to come into the hospital setup. for the simple reason that they would contact COVID and they would land up into more of a soup than be then get benefited by a transplant. So the numbers have definitely dropped down, but over a period of time, the Indian Society of Organ Transplant and the government laid down protocols by which we can and we have been going on going ahead with transplants. Quite a few patients have successfully undergone transplant even in this endemic pandemic. So we do check for the COVID related symptoms, any symptoms which are suggestive of COVID. The RT-PCR swab is done. The staff members are given a questionnaire which they follow, which has been set by the government of India. So carrying out these norms, we have been going ahead with transplants, definitely so. And for the patient's benefit, we do RT-PCR tests for COVID, two tests 1 week apart, just to ascertain that he is not in the asymptomatic or the subclinical phase before he is taken up for surgery. So with the norms and with the protocols that have been set up by the government, it is safe enough to undergo a transplant. The question of immunosuppression after the transplant, that does come up because the patients have to be on immunosuppressants post-transplant so that their kidney does not get rejected. So there have been, the patients have been instructed that they follow all protocols, all COVID norms, so that they don't get exposed. The attendant or the relatives of the patients are also explained about the need for social distancing, wearing a proper mask, and not visiting or not going into crowded places. So with all these precautions in place and the norms and the protocols that have been set by the government of India, transplant is still possible, and we have been doing transplants successfully. In the last year, just to quote, we did about 22 transplants. Of course, that is much less than what we do yearly. And in this year, we have close to done already 20 transplants. So it is not that we cannot or we should not be doing transplants. With the given norms and with the given precautions that we need to follow, these transplants can still happen with a good result.
And the first 6 weeks to 8 weeks of checkups, normally we visit newly transplanted patients tend to visit the hospitals much more for their one-on-one consulting. Is that happening directly or it's now, is it?
I can probably answer this in two phases, meaning patients who have been on a stable transplant after a period of time. For them, we carry out what is called as either teleconsultation or telemedicine, wherein the patient does get his test done at a peripheral center nearby, and he posts or he sends with the social media, with the WhatsApp and with the mail facilities that are available. Most of us are now getting their reports and sharing their prescriptions on the social media, and we do reply them on their questionnaire or on their WhatsApp. But for the ones who have recently undergone a transplant, we of course advise them to come and see us in the hospital with all norms. Now, most of the hospitals during the active phase, of course, fortunately now the second wave is on the recede and we are not yet facing the third wave. So right now the norms are relaxed by the government of Maharashtra and the government of India. But even when these strict norms or strict isolation COVID-related protocols were being followed, each and every hospital had a triage area wherein each and every patient which was entering the hospital was triaged to see whether he is suffering or he is likely to have COVID, wherein he was sent to the flu OPD or to the fever OPD, which was apart or which was totally segregated from the main building or from the main hospital. So there was no intermixing of the patients who were suspect or who were suffering from COVID with the routine patients that were coming to the hospital for their routine needs. Obviously, if in the COVID area also, our other patients need to be treated. So with a proper triage and with a proper questionnaire and with separation of the two group of patients, we were carrying out follow-ups in the immediate post-transplant period, as you rightly said, the first 6 to 8 weeks, which are crucial, wherein the patients do need to come to the hospital twice a week.
Thank you, Doc. Let's dive into some of the questions that have come in from the community. The first question is, after 21 years of transplant, what should the TAC levels be? I'm on cyclosporine.
If you're on cyclosporine, then you would be doing cyclosporine. So the C0 level, if you said you are on cyclosporine, so it would be the cyclosporine level which is of importance. Hello?
Yeah, Doc.
So the cyclosporine level is anywhere between 100 to 150 milligrams per deciliter for a period of 21 years.
Okay.
Monitoring of levels is very important in the initial few months of transplant, wherein you need to have a stable immunosuppressant. 21 years down the line, I suppose your levels would not matter much.
Okay. Our next question is from a person who's been transplanted 3 years back. And the person says, I have proteinuria. At what level should I seek medical help? And how much level of 24 hours proteinuria should I seek help? What causes proteinuria in post-transplant? Is high BP associated with proteinuria?
These three things are interrelated. I mean, if you have even mild proteinuria, you need to see your nephrologist immediately, because proteinuria indicates the first damage or the earliest damage to the transplanted kidney. Normally, you should not be having any proteins in your urine. The causes can be wide and many. If you have a new onset diabetes, then that diabetes post-transplant can affect the kidneys. That can be a cause of your proteinuria. Then early rejection, which is of a major concern in the post-transplant period, does give rise to proteinuria as one of its manifestations. The antibody-mediated rejection, wherein the glomeruli start getting affected, that causes proteinuria. So even if you have a slightest of protein, you should get a 24-hour urine protein excretion and see your consulting physician. What was the other part of the question you said?
Which level of 24-hour proteinuria should I seek help?
Even at the mildest of proteinuria, you should seek help. Hypertension by itself also can cause proteinuria. Your transplant physician will alter your blood pressure medicines, probably see into what your TAC levels are. Yeah, high level of TAC toxicity also can cause proteinuria. So it is not a good idea to stay at home if you have detected that you are started passing proteins in your urine.
What I hear you saying, Doc, that there are many levels that can actually affect your proteinuria. So just asking you, so is this a reversible thing when you diagnose it early by altering the BP medicine?
Yeah, it is definitely reversible. If not totally reversible, it is controllable. See, proteinuria by itself causes further damage to the kidney. Higher the protein loss in your urine, more is the damage likely to be. So if someone has a proteinuria of, say, less than 1 gram in 24 hours, when we were talking about a 24-hour urine protein excretion, that is, I would say, not good, but then better than someone who is having a 3 gram proteinuria. So if that connotation is clear, so the lesser amount of protein in the urine, and fortunately we are having drugs which would reduce the amount of protein excretion in the urine. Of course, if the proteinuria is moderate or mild or more than mild or moderate to severe, then we normally go ahead with a biopsy to find out what the cause of proteinuria is. One, as I said, could be an antibody-mediated rejection. The other is what we call it as someone can have the recurrence of their primary disease. So if you've had a kidney disease which affected your native kidneys, some of these group of diseases, which we call as the glomerular diseases like FSGS or some varieties of MPGN, these are likely to get affected, likely to affect the transplanted kidney. So only a biopsy would ascertain what the cause of proteinuria is. And the earlier you detect it, the better would it be amenable to treatment. So if someone is having a protein leak in the urine, he should immediately consult his transplant physician.
Other than the protein leak in the urine, is there any other signs that we know that we could have a hike in the proteinuria?
Apart from protein, if you wait for signs and symptoms to develop, they would be probably late. So that is the reason why we monitor our patients on a more regular basis. See, unless your proteinuria is to a great extent, so as to cause a drop in your serum albumin, wherein it will manifest as a part of peripheral swelling, pedal edema. So that, as I said, would be a stage where I wouldn't want my patients to be in, because that probably is a reversible stage, and it would be an ongoing damage which would further drop the kidney function. So you should not be waiting for your signs and symptoms to come up if you are having proteins in the urine.
Thank you, Doc, for that. Doc, this is a continuation for this. So how regularly do you think post-transplant patients should check for proteinuria?
We normally do it as a baseline immediately, say about a month of patient's post-transplant period. And if he is doing well, if his creatinine is remaining stable, if his follow-up does not indicate that he is going into hypertension, once in 3 months, a spot sample is good enough. And if that shows some amount of protein leakage, then, as I said, we go ahead with more specific and more specific tests so as to quantify either by a 24-hour urine proteins or by doing a protein creatinine ratio or urine microalbumin urea.
So once in 3 months, right? Thank you, Doc. Our next question is from a 3-month-old transplanted patient. I had a transplant 3 months ago and I faced drop in BP very often. I'm not on BP medication, so what could be the reason?
Normally what happens is most of our patients before transplant have a very high blood pressure, require quite a few drugs to control their blood pressure. One sign of a good and a successful functioning graft is their blood pressure medicines or the requirement of their antihypertensives do come down. So if someone has been on antihypertensive medications, then their BP would drop. So you need to titrate your blood pressure medicines according to what your BP is. But if you are not on any drugs, and despite that, if your blood pressure is dropping, then it is something to be looked into. And the causes could be anything, like any particular cause for drop in blood pressure in the form of, say, either hypovolemia, loose motions, or any cardiac illness, which will need to be ruled out. So without drugs, if someone's blood pressure is remaining less than, say, 110/70 or maybe 120/80, then he needs to seek medical attention.
Okay.
And of course, if it is with the drugs, then you obviously would probably stop your antihypertensive medications and see what your blood pressure comes up to.
Okay. Thank you, Doc. Somebody wants to know, post-transplant, what are the other health checkups that is a must do? One of it, the patient heard that dental checkups is important post-transplant. What are the other checkups that you would recommend for a post-transplant patient?
Most of us monitor the patient's blood sugars, because the drugs that we give do cause post-transplant diabetes. So on a regular basis, blood sugars are monitored. Similarly, these drugs cause lipid abnormalities. So they can get hypercholesterolemia, hypertriglyceridemia. So once in 3 months, monitoring of lipids, if not strictly in 3 months, at least in 6 months, you would need to monitor and look at what your lipid profile is behaving like. And sugars, as I said, on a regular checkup, apart from whatever clinical examination your nephrologist would be doing, like monitoring your blood pressure, these are the tests which are recommended to be done on a regular basis.
And next question for you is, Doc, what are the signs of rejections that we should look out for?
In the later phases, the rejection can be a very indolent or sort of would not manifest. But in the acute phase, where we are worried of the acute rejection, the urine output starts dropping in the immediate post-transplant period, that is maybe in a few days after transplant. We say what is called as a graft tenderness, meaning the transplanted kidney starts becoming tender. So it starts paining you. Then there are non-specific symptoms like general well-being not being good, fever coming up, but all these are not very specific. The only way of catching a rejection is a drop in urine output, blood pressure going high, and obviously the kidney functions worsening. So we do a serum creatinine. That's the reason why I said patients do need at least twice a month, for twice a week follow-up in the first few weeks of transplant. So if the creatinine, which was stable, which was absolutely normal, starts creeping up, you know that everything is not good and you need to intervene.
Thank you, Doc. Our next question, I'm going to alter a little bit, but I'm going to say what the person is exactly asked. The person wants to know, what is the frequency of TAC test for a person to be done post 3 years of transplant? But I'm going to request you to tell us early transplant, and when do you think these frequencies change? Maybe 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. And if you can break it up for the next 20 years of transplant.
that's too long a period. If someone has a very successful transplant, 20 years, the immunosuppressants would definitely come down and he would be on minimal immunosuppressants. But to take your question head on, as you rightly said, the TAC level monitoring is done more frequently in the initial few days or few weeks of transplant. So typically the first TAC level that all of us do is on day 4 of transplant. So the patient is started on tacrolimus, say -1 or -2, that is 1 or 2 days before the transplant. And it takes about 3 or 4 days for the tacrolimus levels to stabilize. So the first TAC level is done on day 4. And if that is adequate, if your kidney function is normal, then the second TAC level is done just before the discharge. So it's either the 7th or 8th day. After that, maybe in the first 1 month, maybe after 1 week or after 2 weeks, but everything depends upon how stable your graft function is and what was your initial TAC level. Now there is a very, individual variation in the absorption of tacrolimus. So given a particular dose, or most of us start off with a standard dose that is recommended, but not everyone would behave in a similar fashion. So you have rapid metabolizers, rapid absorbers. So some patients with the same dose may achieve an adequate TAC level, as against that, if someone is a very poor absorber. So in that case, we will have to build up the dose of the TAC to bring it up to the desired level. So depending upon what your initial TAC level is, you decide when the next TAC dose is to be, when the next TAC level is to be done. This is for the initial, say, 1 to 1.5 months. The first 3 months, as every one of us says, are crucial as far as the graft function and the engraftment is concerned. Chances of rejection are maximum in the first 3 to 6 months. So you have to be very careful. You have to be meticulous in monitoring these patients. So if the patient is doing well, then after about 3 months, once in a month for the say first 6 months, and then later on as and when required. Years down the line, just once in 6 months or something, and knowing that it is in the desired level. Of course, the TAC level also varies according to what stage of transplant we are in. The recommended TAC level would not be the same as it is in the first month if someone is talking about a person who is in the, say, second year of transplant. In the first year, we target TAC levels of up to about 8 to 12 nanograms per ml. And as the months pass by, it is brought down to around 5 to 6 months at the end of 6 months. Later on, anywhere between 3 to 5 nanograms per ml. That also depends upon what other immunosuppressants that the patient is on. So the TAC level would vary according to the desired TAC level. I'm not saying the TAC level that comes out as a result. So the desired TAC level would vary depending upon what stage of transplant you are in. And as I said, in the initial few months, at least 1.5 to 3 months, the monitoring is more frequent depending upon what the levels are and how the creatinine is behaving. After that, it is individual choice, usually once in 6 months for about 6 to 12 months, and then later on as and when required.
Okay. I'm going to go a little more in detail. As and when required, would you recommend at least doing it once a year just to have an idea of what your TAC levels are?
Yeah, I think so. Once a year, we would probably want to know. More so to reduce the dose of TAC. See, all of us know that TAC by itself, tacrolimus by itself, is a nephrotoxic drug. When you are using tacrolimus, so it is so as to say a double-edged sword. It is a very potent immunosuppressant. It is one of the most potent immunosuppressants which all of us need in the immediate post-transplant period. But at the same time, if your TAC levels or if your TAC dose is high, that by itself is going to damage your transplanted kidney. It has a very serious nephrotoxicity. So once you are maybe 6 months down the line, you try and maintain your kidney function to a minimum recommended level. So as I said, your question is pertinent in that sense that if your levels are on the higher side, you are more liberal to bring it down, not fearing a rejection that might happen. So more than building up the TAC level, later on after years of transplant, you can reduce the dose of TAC drastically to achieve minimum of nephrotoxicity that is associated with tacrolimus.
The idea of asking some numbers over here is basically to kind of put a protocol, since we are specializing in post-transplant medicines and tests, that people can actually have a reality check, is this is what we've been doing, because some of us is just taking it, we just forget about our tests, and which is in a lot of way good, but sometimes just being reminded why we have to do these protocols after X amount of time, so that a stitch in time saves nine.
Yeah, absolutely.
Doc, that gets me to my next question. So is the science of understanding TAC level same even in a second transplant for a person who's done the second or the third transplant?
The first transplant, we say that it is immunologically not a very high risk transplant. Of course, there are other parameters and other criteria by which we go in categorizing someone as a high risk or a low risk immunologically transplant. A second transplant and a third transplant is definitely a high risk, high immunologically risk transplant. So there, in that case, you would probably target TAC levels which are on the higher side of the desired level. So if you say that in the first 1 month the TAC level should be around 8 to 12, then in a second or more so in a third transplant, I would probably target it to above 10. But if it is a first transplant, I would be happy being around 8 or 9. So in a second or a third transplant, you always have to be more cautious, because the transplanted kidney by itself acts as a high risk, because that produces antibodies which are there in the circulation. Most of the times the first graft is lost because of rejection, which is immunologically mediated. So you know that this particular patient has lost his first kidney because of an immunologically mediated rejection. In which case you would target a higher TAC level in the second or the third transplant.
And the testing would be the same?
Would be more stringent, more vigilant. So it would be probably more frequent than in the first transplant.
So it will become a compulsion. You have to do it every 6 months.
Later on also, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Doc, for that answer. And the next question that we have is, under what conditions is it necessary in a post-transplant individual to do a biopsy?
I can answer this in two different ways. There are a few academic institutes and centers where they do what are called as protocol biopsies. I mean, they do biopsies at say 1 month, 3 months, 6 months and 12 months. And then maybe at 2 years, irrespective of whatever the graft function is. But most centers or in clinical practice, that is not feasible, because it is an invasive procedure. It does involve a cost along with it. So most of the times, if someone is having a good and a stable kidney function, the creatinine is not rising, the output is good, the blood pressure and all other parameters that are being monitored, we do a biopsy if there is a rise in serum creatinine, that is the kidney function test that we do. And we have found and we have ruled out other causes of worsening of kidney function. So meaning there is no obvious cause. See, the creatinine can go up to so many other causes also. Someone has loose motion, someone has say diarrhea, and he is hypotensive for a while. The creatinine will go up. Someone gets a urinary tract infection. Someone gets admitted with a pneumonia. All these causes are, so as to say, not directly related to the graft. They would rise in any patient. If you or I were to have any of these illnesses, maybe our creatinine or maybe our urine routine, urine output may drop for a while. But when you have no cause for a rising creatinine or for a worsening of kidney function, you would, your nephrologist would suggest a biopsy. And as we were on for about 10-15 minutes back, if there is a protein which is newly coming up in your urine, if you're having a significant proteinuria, and even if your kidney function or your creatinine is normal, then the nephrologist would advise to do a biopsy, which is, these are the two or three main indications wherein we decide on a biopsy if the creatinine or the kidney function worsens, and where you don't, when there is no obvious cause for a worsening of kidney function.
Doc, something that caught my attention is your first part of the answer that you gave, because definitely I'm aware of doing a biopsy when your parameters don't look normal and the doctor is searching for something. Why would biopsies be as a protocol done once in a year? What are the pros of the same procedure? The
pros are, it does have its own advantages. We all of us know that creatinine is not a very good, even if that is the only marker that we have, it is not a very good or it is not an early indicator of kidney dysfunction. Many things have been happening in the past for the creatinine to rise today. So there is what is called as a subclinical rejection, which cannot be picked up on the routine tests that we do. So if someone has to pick up a subclinical rejection, the protocol biopsies is the only answer, wherein you have changes histopathologically, but your biochemical parameters or your lab investigations do not show it. So that's the reason why centers, especially in Australia and New Zealand, there are advocates who advocate a protocol biopsy even not for academic reasons. So you can alter your immunosuppressants if you pick up a rejection which is subclinical, and the survival or maybe preserving the graft function is much better if you catch it early or if you pick it up early in the subclinical stage. What I mean is,
so in a sense, doing biopsies are, but two points. In a sense, doing biopsies is like catching anything earlier.
Even before it is apparent. When it is apparent, obviously you cannot you cannot turn an eye to it. But if you have to pick up things before your warning signals have started coming up, then protocol biopsies are mandatory. And as I said, you should have a very low threshold for doing a biopsy. What I mean by that is, even if you are not comfortable with the way that your patient is doing, you should go ahead with a biopsy. That may sound a bit aggressive or maybe a bit interventional, but if you have to pick up things where you can probably reverse the dysfunction or the abnormality that is going to happen in the future, you have to be very aggressive in doing a transplant biopsy.
Okay. Doc, I would like to also touch upon the cons of doing a biopsy, because it's an invasive procedure. Would it cause any damage for the transplanted kidney?
Damage, it is like any other invasive procedure. It has its own complications, but the complication rates are quite less. It can cause bleeding, meaning hematuria is the commonest complication, blood in the butt. All of us, with the new techniques and with the ultrasound guided, these complications have definitely come down, meaning they are not as frightful procedure as it used to be in the past. USG guided with the smooth small caliber needles that we use nowadays, it has become a fairly safe procedure. So the cons are the bleeding risk that the patient would have. By itself, if there is no hematuria, it does not have much of a complication. But by itself, it could not cause any damage or any loss of kidney function. If that was what you were probably trying to ask.
Pretty much what we want to hear in a nutshell. Our next question is there any fundamentals on how much water needs to be consumed post a transplant? People recommend 4 to 5 liters. Is that the right amount?
That again would depend upon what kind of a kidney function you're having. Presuming that everything is good, you should drink as much water as you can, because the kidney should not get hypoperfused. It should have adequate volume So around 3 liters, 4 liters, depending upon what. So quite a few of our patients are advised to monitor their urine output at home. I mean, I regularly ask them to keep a diary wherein they maintain their intake and output. That tells us whether the patient is adequately hydrated or not, because hydration does definitely play an important role in maintaining adequate kidney function.
And since this is a part of your practice of making patients actually write down their input and output, do you do this in the initial 6 months to 1 year, or is it
not that long? I mean, the patient has his own job to go back to. So maybe about one and a half months, when the things are very critical, they monitor. After that, we start monitoring their weight.
Okay. So
if there is a drop in urine output, then obviously his weight would start going up. As long as he's at home, quite a few of my patients are very aggressive and want to join back their duties maybe in a month's time. So obviously I cannot. And of course now work from home has become a norm. But then earlier when people were expected to go to their offices, you can't expect them to carry a bottle and keep measuring. So it would be, and of course after about one and a half months, you are fairly certain that whatever you have done, you have done a good job. Your kidney is functioning well and you have other parameters to monitor.
Because like on the weekends or the days that my husband's at home, he's twice transplanted. He makes sure he checks his urine output. So he has an constant.
How many years after his second transplant is he?
Transplant, it's now coming into 2 years. But he has an understanding of this much I've consumed and this is what my output was.
Yes, I think so. That is a very good thing. In fact, quite a few of our patients do understand things better. I mean, I have full credit to your husband that he's so meticulous 2 years down the line that he's monitoring that. And if they're doing it well and good, I mean, that is an indication of early dysfunction of the kidney or worsening of kidney functions.
Sometimes I thought he forgets that he's got a closet and he's used to using a mug all the time. Okay. Our next question is the question come on dialysis?
Sorry, if?
The next question that's come up is on dialysis.
But it's on dialysis, okay.
Yeah. What precautions to take for the heart by a dialysis patient? The patient is 4 years suffering on the journey of CKD and on dialysis.
Oh, that's a very good question, even if it is not pertaining to the topic that we are discussing today. All said and done, cardiovascular mortality and morbidity is the commonest cause of death in our subgroup of patients with CKD. CKD by itself is a pro-inflammatory state and is a risk factor for worsening or for developing a cardiovascular disease. So regular monitoring of your blood sugars, if you are a diabetic and if you're still needing anti-diabetic medications, controlling your blood pressure well, controlling your water intake and fluid overload, taking care of your calcium and mineral bone disease, meaning your calcium, phosphorus and alkaline phosphatase. All of our patients have what is called as secondary hyperparathyroidism. And what actually happens is their blood vessels start getting calcified, meaning there is actually deposition of calcium salts in their blood vessels, which causes a narrowing of their blood vessels. So your calcium, your phosphorus, your PTH, parathyroid hormone levels, have to be in the desired levels so as to prevent you from having a coronary artery disease secondary to your CKD MBD, that is what we call it as, mineral bone disease. So CKD MBD, mineral bone disease, is an independent risk factor as far as coronary artery disease or cardiovascular disease is concerned in our patients with CKD on dialysis. So all these parameters, your anemia should be well controlled with say either with either erythropoietin or iron supplements. So a desired anemia correction of 10 to 12 grams per deciliter of hemoglobin, a desired calcium, phosphorus, alkaline phosphatase level, lipid profile. Quite a few patients of ours do have lipid abnormalities, which is a very well-known risk factor in the general population. Sugars, if they are high, hypertension, most of our patients on dialysis, if they are underdialyzed, if they are fluid overloaded, are hypertensive. So if they do need drugs, they should be continued on antihypertensive. So these 5-6 parameters are being monitored on a regular basis by the consulting nephrologists of patients who are on dialysis. Important thing to note is the others are well known to everyone. The physicians also know this. But mineral bone disease and calcium metabolism is an independent risk factor which needs to be corrected.
Thank you, doctor. Next question is not about any treatments post-transplant, but they want to know the ABOI transplant. How many transplants may be added to the additional donor pool?
It's a very good question. Quite a few centers, and in fact, Jahangir also has started doing ABO incompatible transplant. We've done close to about 25 transplants in the last 5 years. So earlier it was that only an ABO matched kidney can be transplanted, but of late we have been confident in transplanting ABO incompatibles, and this would probably add almost as high as 30% of patients would get benefited by an ABO incompatible transplant. That is what the international percentage is. So if centers which are doing ABO incompatible transplants, 30% of the transplants can probably be done with an ABO incompatible donor.
Doc, getting into creating an awareness of the test that should be done at different stages post-transplant. Can you hear me, Doc?
Yeah, I'm there. Hello.
Yeah, I can hear you, Doc. I can hear you, Doctor.
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I'm there. Yeah, I can hear you right too.
Okay. Getting into the test that should be done regularly post-transplant, can you give us the compulsory to-do test in the first 3 months post-transplant? And then we'll move to the 6 months, and then we'll move to the 1 year, and we'll take it from there.
The tests that need to be done in the first 3 months would include a complete blood count, just to find out whether there's any. In the first 3 months, as I said, the chances of rejection are high. So also because of a high immunosuppressants and because of a possibility of you having received induction, chances of infections are also high. So on a regular basis, hemogram or a complete blood count is done. Obviously, kidney functions are monitored on a regular basis. Your immunosuppressants are high, so your blood sugars will need to be monitored more frequently in the first 3 months. And after about 3 months, a lipid profile. Later on, maybe only a blood count and a kidney function test, that is the serum creatinine, on a monthly basis are done regularly, depending upon what your TAC levels and what your TAC dose is. TAC levels once in a month, maybe after 3 months, till you are, say, about a year down the line in transplant.
Doc, can I make a point here? Let's consider a case study of somebody who's got his levels normal, all levels. So let's just consider that as a case study. All levels are normal. What are the tests to be done?
There again, as he progresses in his transplant, you would be wanting to reduce the TAC dose. So again, even if you are having a normal TAC level or a desired TAC level, you would still do it, say, in the first year, once in a month, to bring down the TAC dose to a minimum that you can probably achieve. Because as I said, all of us are concerned about the long-term TAC toxicity or the chronic allograft nephropathy that the TAC drug by itself can cause. So even if you are having a stable TAC level, you would probably still want to do a TAC level, may not be as frequent as if your TAC levels are fluctuating, but at least once a month in the first 1 year. And then later on, once your dose has come down to a bare minimum, maybe once in 6 months.
Okay. And the other protocols of doctor's visits post 1 year of transplant, how regularly would you recommend the patient doing their test and meeting their doctors physically? This is from 1 to 3 years.
At least I would want my patients to come to me for follow-up, because there are certain things that the patient or the lab reports may not pick up. So the way a diabetic or a hypertensive or a patient with heart disease needs to follow up, even if you are having good kidney function, it is advisable for you to have a regular follow-up, if not once a month, at least once in 3 months, years down the line. But for the first 1 year, at least once a month is mandatory. Hello?
Yeah, yes, Doc. I'm here. I'm right there with you. My internet seems to be fluctuating, so I take off the camera, but I can hear you. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Because you were you were blanked, so I thought you were disconnected.
I'm right there. And with this protocol, so once in 3 months, so post 3 years of transplant to 5 years, we'll still stick to the once in 3 months visiting of the hospitals and doing your regular blood work.
I would still probably want that to happen. I would okay. advise that.
Okay. Ideally.
Ideally, yeah. In the interest of the patient, of course.
Yeah, yeah. There's some new questions coming in, so I'm just going to take a look at that. Is there any test that you recommend that is not taken seriously, but in your practice that you think it's important for the patients to at least check once a year so that they catch anything on time? Is there any test that is underrated? We don't really practice on a day-to-day, not day-to-day, but in our post-transplant life.
As I said, monitoring lipid levels and correcting them is one test which may or may not be taken very seriously. Then once in a year, Doppler studies. But that, if your kidney functions are normal, maybe you can probably give away with it. But an ultrasound and monitoring sugars and lipids.
Okay. Since you mentioned the ultrasound.
Doppler, transplant Doppler.
Okay. Okay. In fact, our next question is pretty similar to that. How frequently should we do a scan / USG on the graft post-transplant?
Definitely, if there is a problem, immediately. If everything is stable, it may not be required unless there is any problem that is happening. But once in a year, maybe just to see the perfusion of the kidneys, and if the flow of urine is, there is no obstruction, once in a year is good enough. But it's not absolutely mandatory or not absolutely recommended. Not one of the recommendations that you normally would advise.
And can you give us an insight of the eye test and the bone density test post-transplant?
Yeah, that is one thing which needs to be monitored, because patients who are on steroids do have their bone densities going down or having osteopenia. So calcium phosphorus, alkaline phosphatase monitoring is required. And of course, if they are abnormal, bone density, meaning the hexa scan, the bone scan should be done maybe once after a year. And if it is showing some amount of loss of bones, then maybe calcium supplements using zoledronate or something to remineralize the bone would be taken into.
Our next question is, if creatinine is within the range, but the patient experiences pain in the graft site, should there any further tests be done?
Yeah, you will obviously need to address to that. One common cause of having a normal, of course, the creatinine would probably go high if you have what is called as a transplant pyelonephritis, meaning there is, if there is some infection in your transplanted kidney, then again, the kidney would probably be painful. So that you would need to do a urine test and maybe a ultrasound and a Doppler study of the transplanted kidney to find out why your kidney is either painful or tender.
This is a transplant patient who's 21 years post-transplant at the age of 68, and the transplant happened in the year 2000. The patient experiences some kind of stiffness and stress in the chest and the abdomen area, but not pain, just stiffness and discomfort. They want to know that post-transplant, 21 years post-transplant, the cyclosporine levels at 78 normal. Is it fine? And two is, what could be the other reasons for having the stiffness on the chest and abdomen area?
Obviously, it is not related to the cyclosporine or to your kidney functions. It is not related to your transplant at all. So you would probably need to see a physician and rule out a cardiac. At your age, with those drugs going on, with the steroids, with the cyclosporine, all of these drugs we know are atherogenic. So ischemic heart disease would probably need to be ruled out at that stage of transplant. So if you're having a chest discomfort, upper abdominal pain, manifestations need not be there. So maybe an ECG, or if required, a 2D echo, and if the suspicion is there, then maybe more invasive tests to rule out an ischemic or a coronary artery disease.
And it just out of curiosity, is just the tightening of the chest, because we also remember this patient telling us that they experience a lot of stress. So I'm trying to understand with the stress, the tightening of the chest, would you still want them to go for further investigation?
If it is an organic symptom, stress meaning mental stress that he's going through, is it?
Yeah, I mean, yes, mental stress.
Then in that case, if that is affecting his, if the psyche is affecting, or if your mind is affecting your body, you obviously need to do something for that. So you need to check your blood pressure. If you had that stress is causing a rise in blood pressure, if it is causing a rise in your blood sugars, so irrespective of whether it is mental or physical, you need to rule out. All that can happen is you may have a normal, your investigations will all be normal. So there's no harm in getting a normal report. In fact, it is good to get a normal report.
Yes, it's very good to get a normal report.
Yeah.
My next question is, if I miss a dose of Cellcept or Procept or mistakenly interchange medicines on a particular time, suppose Procept consumed when I should have taken Cellcept, what should I do? Suppose Procept is consumed when I should have taken Cellcept, what should I do? Should I be concerned?
Procept is what? Is it MMF? If it is the same drug, then there is no harm in replacing one drug for the other.
Okay.
But if you have missed a particular drug, the earlier you take it, the better it is. You cannot miss drugs for a prolonged period of time, irrespective of how many years down the line that you are in transplant. Because we've had patients 5, 10, 15 years post-transplant and missing their medications, one or two doses. So the earlier, as soon as you realize that you have missed a particular drug, as soon as you realize that, you should take that dose immediately. We've had patients who have missed one or two doses of all their immunosuppressants and landed up with antibody mediated rejection, which are very difficult to treat. I must make a mention that late onset antibody mediated rejections are the ones which cannot, or which are very difficult to reverse. If you get a, God forbid, if someone gets a rejection in the initial few days of transplant, we can still tide over it and we can still cover it up. But someone who is, a chronic, meaning after 6 months, after 1 year, you have to be particular in not missing whatever dose that you have taken, whatever dose that you are advised.
So if you have that doubt, just take your dose double.
Yeah, even if you double it, it is okay. I mean, many a times that patients say that they are supposed to take, say, tacrolimus at 8 o'clock, and they don't remember whether they have taken it or not. And they cannot keep an account of whatever tablets that are left behind. The best advice is, there is no harm in taking a second dose rather than missing or skipping the total dose totally.
Another question has come on TAC, Doc. I think you probably would have answered it, but I'll still take it for the benefit of the patient because it just come up. My TAC is 8.2 and I am 2.5 months post-transplant. Is the level
5 years?
2.5 months.
2.5 months, 8.5. If the creatinine is normal, if everything is normal, I would probably want to reduce or downgrade, down titrate the TAC dose marginally. Because we target usually 8 to 12, and by about 6 months, we should probably aim at going down to 6 nanograms per ml.
A very interesting question. When you're talking about 20 years post-transplant, what do you think practically would be the perfect creatinine level to maintain at post 20 years?
The lesser the better.
So one is good. One is good.
Yeah. But 20 years down the line, you don't expect it to remain at one. There would be some rise in serum creatinine.
Okay.
The other parameters, whether the patient has, say, proteinuria, new onset diabetes, or hypertension coming up, all these factors will definitely make a role. And if the creatinine is stable, then I would probably minimize the immunosuppressant, because 10 years, or there is no specified time, but there is a concept about accommodation coming up. So the kidney, the transplanted kidney gets accommodated and the chances of rejection do come down. So you are safe in reducing your immunosuppressants. You meaning not you as a patient, but your nephrologist is safe. I mean, this should not be taken in the wrong sense that Dr. Ambike said you reduce your immunosuppressants and the patient starts doing it on his own. So that is what should not happen. But the nephrologist is confident enough to reduce your immunosuppressants to a bare minimum after, say, 20 years, as you are saying, for this patient.
So while we spoke about one being the ideal number, what is a number that is still okay because you're 20 years post-transplant?
You don't have a choice, man. Whatever it is, you try and preserve whatever you are left with.
Okay, thank you, Doc. Let's talk about the current period of the COVID situation. After being COVID negative, is there possibilities for the creatinine to still rise up?
See, COVID by itself can cause acute kidney injury, acute tubular necrosis. Quite a few of our patients post-transplant, transplanted many years down the line, had got COVID, especially so in this second wave. And their creatinines or their kidney functions did go up. But with the successful treatment of COVID, and the all of us now have been using methylprednisolone, reducing the immunosuppressants depending upon how severe the COVID was, you expect the creatinine to come back to, or the kidney function to come back to whatever its baseline level was. If after COVID and say after a few months after your successful COVID treatment, the creatinine does not come down, that is a matter of concern which will need to be looked into.
And what are the other ways to work on creatinine post-COVID? Is it only consumption of your water content? Is there any other to-do thing?
No, see, what happens is in the acute phase, normally, earlier, what was advocated was the MMF, the CellCept that you just spoke about, was, or the anti-metabolite. Most of our patients are on triple drug immunosuppressants. One is the steroid, one is a CNI, that is either cyclosporine or tacrolimus, and the third one is an anti-metabolite. So the universal practice was, in the acute phase, if it is a moderate to severe COVID, the anti-metabolite should be withdrawn, because the risk of dying of COVID is more than the graft loss. And obviously, the steroids are going to be hiked up. Most of us advocate either 8 milligram of dexamethasone or 40 milligram of methylprednisolone in the acute stage. And then you taper that off. And after 28 days or after a month of successful treatment of COVID, you go back to your immunosuppressant. But then during the period that all these jugglery or all these changes in your immunosuppressants were happening, there is a fair chance that there might be some rejection which may have set in. So if it is COVID related, after the successful treatment of COVID, your kidney functions will come back to normal. But if they remain high, you will need to rule out any rejection which may have happened during that period of time.
Is there any other signs that we can look at if the situation is the second part of your answer, that the creatinine is not normal, not going down, and it could be a rejection that could have happened during the time of the COVID period? Is there any other signs that they can
try to rule out all other causes, meaning your hydration is good, your blood pressure is maintained, your ultrasound does not show any obstruction to the kidneys. After all these have been ruled out, and after a certain period of time, you have given, say, about 4 weeks post-transplant for the COVID recovery to happen. If the creatinine still does not come back to whatever your baseline was, just to rule out a rejection, we may advocate a kidney biopsy, a transplant biopsy.
So what I hear you saying is a 4 weeks period. So at 4 weeks, we look in for going, if your creatinine is not coming down, we look in for going for a biopsy.
You need a biopsy, yeah. After you ruled out other causes of worsening creatinine.
Thank you, doctor. Our next question is, I had a transplant on the 19th of January, 2021, and now my creatinine level is 176 and my albumin is trace. Is it safe for me right now to take the vaccination?
Vaccination is recommended. Nowadays, they say that you can take vaccination after your immunosuppressants have been reduced. See, the only harm or the only disadvantage in taking a vaccine when you are on very high doses of immunosuppressants is you will not respond, or you will not build up an immune response. So it does not cause, or it does not have any extra side effects as far as the side effect profile of the vaccine is concerned. the only pitfall or the only drawback is if you are so badly immunosuppressed, you may not benefit from taking a vaccine. So nowadays, you recommend to take the vaccine and the booster, the second dose also, presuming that your immune response will happen. It is better than taking not taking the vaccine at all.
I really like the way you put the answers directly to the point that taking the vaccine post-transplant immediately will not affect the kidney, but you may not pick up antibodies.
Antibodies.
Concern.
So that is what we advise, that just because you have taken your vaccine doesn't mean, and that is an advice to all of us, just because you have taken a vaccine doesn't mean that you are protected from COVID. We've had incidences in our own hospital, healthcare workers, doctors, who have had both their doses, both their shots of vaccine, and still have had a COVID infection in their second wave. So having taken a vaccine should not take you away from wearing a mask, maintaining social distancing, preventing going to crowded places. The natural tendency is that I have taken both my doses, I am protected from COVID, so I can behave the way I want. That is what is the danger in taking a vaccine, if that is the way I look at it. So you should continue with your masking, with your social distancing, with your not going out of the hospital, of your houses, unless it is absolutely mandatory, even if you are fully vaccinated.
Doc, we have reached 7 o'clock, would it be okay for me to take another 10 minutes of your time, because I've got a...
Okay. Yeah, I mean, that's fine.
Yeah, because I really liked a question that somebody's asked, considering these are taboo questions that we don't talk about, is your sex life post-transplant. And something that I really want to kind of bring to your notice, can I have intercourse post-transplant? Is it safe? I'm going to add on to these questions. When is it safe for me to have a child post-transplant? Should I wait for my immunosuppressants to come down? Because... I did my research when I fell pregnant when my husband finished his transplant, and there was an understanding that I did, and I thought it was important to also bring it up here. So first is intercourse post-transplant. When is it advised that you can start normal intercourse? Is there a time?
It's like any other major abdominal surgery. So your wound healing should be adequate, meaning you should not overstress when you're having intercourse. So about 1 to 1.5 months, it is safe for you to have intercourse. About childbearing, it would vary whether it is a female or a male. For a male, it doesn't make much of a difference. What is recommended for our female patients, and now fortunately or unfortunately, we are having these patients in that age group, childbearing age group, in good numbers. So a stable kidney function for 2 years is what we normally recommend. So what do I mean by a stable kidney function? Your creatinine should be less than 1.5. There should be no proteinuria, and your blood pressure should be well controlled with minimum antihypertensive drugs. Why I'm saying this is pregnancy by itself, you have to go through your pregnancy for 9 months. There are so many physiological changes that are happening during those 9 months. So pregnancy by itself is an added burden or an added load onto your transplanted kidney. So you need to have a stable kidney function. So after 2 years, if you feel, and there are quite a few patients of us who have got pregnant after 2 years, but that kind of meaning you have to advise family planning measures in the first 2 years for your female patients who have undergone a transplant.
We actually covered this entire topic on pregnancy and post-transplant. So we did have a lot of insights coming out on that. So I'm assuming that our female patients do have a complete understanding of the right time to fall pregnant and what are the
measures. Pregnant, yeah.
Doc, can you expect to have a normal sex life post-transplant, talking about from a male perspective and a female perspective?
In fact, all your hormonal changes also do get better. So it would be much better than someone who is on dialysis, may it be either a female or a male. So sex life should not be affected after transplant. In fact, you would expect to have a normal sex life post-transplant.
Okay. Thank you, Doc, for that answer. Our next question that's come up is, I have swelling on my leg post-transplant. Why could this be happening?
Swelling on both the legs? Then you would need to monitor your urine output. your blood pressure. Certain medicines like amlodipine or something can cause, and that is the commonest cause of peripheral edema after you have ruled out organic causes. And if it is unilateral, then whether there is any obstruction to your venous blood flow return or something. So it depends, it would vary individually.
I think I have one more question and I'm trying to understand, but I think you'll understand the question better than me. I'm taking Azoran 100 TAC 0.25 morning, 0.5 evening, Visalon 10 mg. I'm open window patient and taking...
I'm
open window patient. I didn't understand that.
What does that mean? Open window patient?
Yeah. Okay,
what is the question? Forget about that.
I'm an open window patient taking pridoxin. Now I'm having neck pain. What treatment should I take?
I didn't get the question. He's taking pyridoxin.
Pyridoxin, but what is open window? I didn't understand. I'll just say the medications once again, doc. I'm taking Azoran 100.
These are the standard medicines that quite a few of our patients would be. The doses also are fortunately less. All that I can say is probably the neck pain that he's having is a totally unrelated sort of either an illness or a symptom, which has nothing to do with the medications that he's taking, unless he means to say an open window patient, meaning whether there is any, occupational hazard. If he has to sit on computers for a long time with his neck flexed like that, then obviously you need to rule out a postural cause for. And if that doesn't answer, then maybe a cervical spine or an MRI spine of the neck, the cervical MRI, and a consult with a spinal surgeon if that doesn't go away. Because neither your normal kidney functions nor the medications that you mentioned are going to cause pain in the neck.
I think the pain in the neck would be whether you are transplanted on the journey of CKD or not on the journey of CKD, having that pain.
Most of us do get neck pains because of the wrong posture that we adopt nowadays.
Yes.
So good morning exercise, yoga, 21st of June should be daily. Our Prime Minister has advocated the International Yoga Day on the 21st of June. So what I suggest is Surya Namaskars and yogas every day would probably answer most of your spine problems and the neck pain that any one of us might be having. So it would be a good idea to spend some time on yourself before you start your day schedule.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, Doctor, for actually so patiently answering all our questions. I think I'm going to ask you the last question, and I've been dwelling into this question from different angles, but I'm going to go directly go into the question because I think it's very important for us on the journey of CKD, be it a caregiver or be it a person who's transplanted. The question is, why is it important to have your doctor's checkup post-transplant, even if you've done 5 years post-transplant or 10 years post-transplant? Because in some of our interviews, we have doctors telling us that some patients just take it for granted over a point of time and they disconnect from their doctors and they connect back when it's too late. So I'm going to ask you to tell us, why is it important not to do that? And come and...
Sorry?
And come and meet you guys regularly.
As I said... Things can go wrong even if you are, say, 20 years down the line. And there are subtle changes, very minute, very subtle changes that can be picked up on your routine visits. Maybe most of the times, after a few years, the prescription will not change. Your lab investigations that your nephrologist advises will not change. And to a great extent, the lab reports that you're getting also will not change. But that doesn't mean that you should not be visiting your transplant physician. As I said, a physician obviously would pick up things at a much earlier time. And that's the reason why, irrespective of your duration of transplant, as I said, if not monthly, but once in 3 months is an absolute mandatory time that I advise my... If someone comes to me once a month, I'm obliged that he's coming to me once a month in his own interest. So here we would monitor and we would pick up a minor rise in your creatinine, a minor increase in the protein excretion that you are having, a mild increase in the blood pressure that you were maintaining with the drugs that you are on. The TAC levels, after a certain time, you need to bring them down. So even if all this is not spelled out to the patient when they come and visit us, but at the back of our mind, this is what we are looking at. This is what we monitor. Even if we don't mention that, or if we, even if it is not communicated, or so good you asked this question. What does a nephrologist do? He just gives me the same prescription. He just asks me for a few tests that I've been doing, and all of these have been normal. But these at the back end or behind the curtain, all these things are at the back of our mind when we are monitoring you when you are coming for a monthly follow-up.
I think even from a doctor's perspective, having that relationship going on, just because our husbands get boring or our wives get boring, we don't leave them and go, right?
Yeah, so, that's right. So the bond is still has to be there.
So I think maintaining that bond with a doctor, because they are our partners on the journey of the CKD at the end of the day. So I think it's so important to have this awareness of even doctors wanting to have that bond through the journey, because when they lose that relationship with the patient, then it's so difficult to take off from 2 years back story or 3 years back story.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And many a times, especially unfortunate, I can just mention it over here. Unfortunate things that have happened, which most transplant physicians will have noticed, is because of the COVID, patients have not come for follow-up for 3-4 months, and then they have with normal kidney functions earlier to the COVID, and then suddenly their creatinine either doubling or rising, and then you do a biopsy, you find a rejection having taken place. So every month follow-up, even if the treatment that was given was being followed up, we've had, all of us have had patients who have lost their kidney functions or have lost their graft because of an irregular follow-up that happened, not because the patient didn't want to come, but because of the COVID and the restrictions and the fear that the COVID had.
And the reason that I actually brought up this question, Doc, I think because post in the COVID period for the last 1.5 years, most of our visits to the hospitals and our testing is drastically come down.
It is reduced.
It's become a habit for us to think it's normal and take it for granted.
It is not required.
Yeah, so that's the reason I brought this up. But on behalf of the Kidney Warrior Foundation, I'd like to say a big thank you to you, Doctor, for joining us this evening. And I would like to take this time to actually say thank you to Biocon, who's our partners on this episode of the series of creating this wonderful awareness of making the journeys on CKD much easier with all the awareness that we've got with wonderful doctors joining us on the team. And anyway, this evening, let's share some love. We always receive those energies, even though we are distant apart, for our lovely doctor who joined us this evening. Thank you, doctor, once again.
Thank you so much. Thank you. My pleasure. Thank you so much.